in the beginning, we have a recorded, video recorded message by Professor Evangelos Venizelos, who used to be also minister in many seats and former vice president of the Greek government. He unfortunately could not be here with us today, but we have a video recorded message which we can watch right now.
Dear colleagues, I have to apologize because extraordinary obligations deprived me of the joy of physical presence at the conference and the opportunity to welcome you in my city, in my birthplace, Thessaloniki, and also in my alma mater studiorum, the University of Thessaloniki. I therefore ask for your understanding for the use of digital means. Congratulations are in order for my dear colleague, my old student, Lina Papadopoulou, whom I watch with admiration along with the other members of the Organising Committee for the impeccable preparation of this relevant, crucial, and ambitious conference. Dear colleagues, such a conference is the most appropriate, substantial, and sensitive way to honor the memory of Professor Charalambos Papastathis, a dear friend and colleague at the Law School of the University of Thessaloniki and the founding member of this consortium. Charalambos Papastathis was an emblematic figure in ecclesiastical and canon law and in the history of Byzantine law, a dedicated and insightful researcher and of rare ability for synthesis, a guardian of the Orthodox tradition, while remaining at the same time cosmopolitan and open to the new currents in international scientific discourse. He passionately served the university, teaching and research, as well as the Hellenic Republic in the critical field of the relationship between state and church. Professor Charalambos Papastathis was an authoritative defender of religious freedom, pluralism, and tolerance. All this while displaying high quality scientific discourse, courtesy, a British sense of humor, and self-sarcasm, proof of his intellectual level and his great culture. His son, Professor Konstantinos Papastathis, a member of the Conference Organizing Committee, continues on some very interesting aspects of his father's work. Dear colleagues, the subject of the conference forces us to once more confront the historical foundations and the foundations of values of European constitutionalism, the foundations and durability of European democracy as one of the two most comprehensive versions of liberal democracy, the second being American liberal democracy. The secular nature of European constitutional culture and the formation of European constitutional ethics different than Christian ethics is the historical, regulatory, normative, and jurisprudential result of a complex process full of conflicts and contradiction that has lasted for about 2.5 centuries. The question, therefore, is whether this acquis of European constitutionalism can suffer a setback and whether we can go back to much earlier stages of the relationship between constitutionalism and religion in order to fully and unrestrictedly protect the religious freedom of Muslims, individuals and communities belonging to the legal orders of European constitutionalism, the national legal orders, the legal order of the European Union and that of the European Convention of Human Rights. The question concerns the institutional framework in which civil society is constituted and operates, the framework of European constitutionalism with its internal pluralism, antinomies and conflicts, and the institutional framework in which the relationship between individual and collective civil society entities with the state and international organization or hybrid entities such as the Council of Europe and the EU operates. Dear colleagues, as you know, Greece possesses long experience of the special legal status of the Muslim minority in Thrace and the implementation of Sharia in the context of the Greek legal order, and therefore of the legal order of the European Union and the legal order of the European Convention of Human Rights. Even with a delay, the Hellenic Republic has the obligation to fully comply with the case law of the European Court of Human Rights. As a former rapporteur of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe on the implementation of the court's judgments, and as a former member of the Committee of Ministers, I express my satisfaction and hope that the Supreme Court of Civil and Criminal Justice, the Arios Pagos Court, will not continue to resist. Accepting the case law of the European Court of Human Rights and the Court of Justice of the European Union is, after all, the simplest and safest way to safeguard the European constitutional acquis. The Greek Constitution is open to its interpretation in accordance with the European Convention and the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights, so that the augmented Constitution can be formed, the Constitution that provides the greatest protection of human rights. The comparison between European constitutionalism and the so-called Islamic constitutionalism, in the light of the latest developments in Afghanistan and in the light of the need to restructure the West as a strategic entity and as a mechanism for protecting democracy, the rule of law and human rights, highlights the stakes at hand. Dear colleagues, European constitutional democracy is sensitive, flexible, pluralistic, liberal, inclusive, but it must also be self-protective. It must ensure the conditions for its survival. This is especially true now in times of multiple and continuous crises, economic, health, climate, and security crises, that are transformed into interpretative dilemmas for the normative text of European constitutionalism. Dear colleagues, a democratic and liberal legality that undermines liberal democracy itself as a culture and as an institutional acquis is reminiscent of the cry of the Bourbon, "La légalité nous tue, legality kills us." History solves the great dilemmas of constitutional theory, the interpretation of the Constitution, and national and international judicial review. The history of the eve of World War I, as well as that of the interwar period, teaches us that sleepwalkers, both political and judicial ones, proved to be calamitous. European constitutionalism respects and protects Islam as a religion and the religious freedom of Muslims, with the only conditions being that both Islam and the Muslims under the jurisdiction of the European legal order respect this European constitutionalism as a lesson and as a historical acquis. Thank you very much.
Now we can proceed with our first speaker, Professor Silvio Ferrari. We all know Professor Silvio Ferrari. He is a member of different international networks. He is a professor of ecclesiastical law for many years in the Faculty of Law of the University of Milan. It's not the first time for him to be among us here in Thessaloniki. We're always honored when we have our grande maestro. The floor is yours, Professor.
Thank you. I am glad I am here, and I give you the opportunity to listen to the words of a grande maestro, as Nikos said. Now, my very short presentation is devoted to the to a research project, which is entitled the Atlas of Religious and Belief Minority Rights. This project aims to map and measure the rights of religious and belief minorities in the EU countries. The project measures not only the rights which are written in the law books, but also their implementation, trying to reduce the gap between law and reality. But in this presentation, speaking to an audience of legal experts, I shall stick to the legal data. That is what I'm going to show regards the legal systems, independent from how much implementation their provisions get. To attain the goal of the Atlas, a number of questionnaires have been sent to national correspondents. Their replies have been studied, analyzed, and a numerical value has been given to each of their answers. In this way, we have been able to build two indexes. First, the index of the promotion of the rights of the religious minorities by states, on the part of the states. And second, the index of equal treatment of religious and belief minorities. Let me start from the first index with this first slide. This slide shows how much the rights of the Muslim communities are promoted in three policy areas: spiritual assistance, education, and religious symbols. The countries where these rights are most promoted are Sweden, Spain, Estonia, and Romania. And this is the first significant point because these countries have a very different cultural, religious, and legal background. Therefore, these data show that it is possible to promote the rights of the Muslim communities moving from different starting points. The countries where these rights are least promoted are Italy, Belgium, Greece. When I speak of Greece, I speak of Greece without trace. I am always speaking of Greece without taking into consideration Thrace, Greece, and France. How can we explain these data? France and Belgium have restricted the wearing of religious symbols, particularly those which cover the face, and therefore they have a low score when we come to the policy area religious symbol. It is true that other countries have similar restrictions. For example, in Austria, we have an anti-burqa law in force. But in France and Belgium, for example, public employees cannot wear religious symbols at the workplace, which is not the case of Austria. And this explains the difference of the score. When we come to Italy and Greece, you see that the low score concerns the area of education. And it is mainly due to the fact that in these two countries, Muslim communities are not entitled to teach their religion in public schools. Therefore, both Italy and Greece obtain a low score when we come to education. This second slide shows the promotion of the rights of the Islamic community compared to that of the Jewish communities. I know that this comparison should be taken with a lot of caveats. The numbers are different, the history is different, etc., etc. However, if we try to compare the data concerning Islamic communities and Jewish communities, the first thing is that, generally speaking, the Jewish communities are in a slightly better position than the Muslim communities all over Europe, with a couple of exceptions. Estonia and Spain are countries where Muslims enjoy more rights than Jews. Also, the difference is a slight one, a little one. The countries where the gap in favor of the Jewish communities is wider are Italy and Hungary. In Italy, it is the same reason I already mentioned. Jews can teach their religion in public schools, Muslims cannot, and this makes the difference. In Hungary, and I am speaking under the control of our colleague Balázs Sándor, the difference is due to the fact that Jews can have chaplains in public institutions like prisons, while Muslims cannot. And here is an interesting point, in my opinion, which is that the difference is not due, as in other countries, to the different numbers of Jews and Muslims living in Hungary. By reading Sándor's report, I learned that in Hungary there are more Jews than Muslims, which is unusual in the European Union countries. So we cannot explain this difference. We could explain this difference saying Jews are more numerous than Muslims, so the need for a chaplain in the hospitals, in the prisons, etc., is more important for Jews than for Muslims. But I do not think that this is the real reason. The real reason is that the presence of the Jewish community in Hungary dates back a long time, while Islamic communities have been active in Hungary only in the last decades. They have a significant number. Now let me move to the second index, the index of the equal treatment of religious and belief minorities. This index measures the equal treatment of religious and belief communities. The results of this slide, of the three slides I'm going to show, indicate that the Muslim communities are placed in a middle position when we come to the equal treatment, immediately after the Judeo-Christian religions and before the religions from Asia and the new religious movements. This is the position of the Muslim communities when we come to the policy areas spiritual assistance and education. But when we come to the policy area religious symbols, the Muslim communities are at the bottom of the ladder of the rights. And this is explained by the fact that in a number of countries there are restrictions that apply to religious symbols of Muslims and do not apply to other religions which do not have religious symbols like the hijab and the burqa. What conclusions can be drawn by these data? I think that we can draw three conclusions. First, the rights of the Muslim communities are more restricted in the area of education and religious symbols, less restricted in the area of spiritual assistance in prisons, in the hospitals, and in the army. Second, the restrictions that are in place on the rights of the Muslim communities in the field of education and religious symbols concern a limited number of countries. France, Belgium, and to a certain extent Austria for religious symbols, Greece and Italy for education. This means that the same problems have been addressed in other countries in a successful way. And final, the third point that can be drawn from this data is that the Islamic communities are never on equal footing on the Christian churches and the Jewish communities. They are not far, but always a little, they enjoy a little less rights than the Christian churches and the Jewish communities. That's all on my part. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Ferrari. Now the floor to His Excellency, Mr. Dr. Ali Rashid Al Nuaimi. His Excellency is the founder and the chairman of the World Muslim Communities Council and the International Center of Excellence for Countering Violent Extremism. Your Excellency, the floor is yours.
Distinguished guest, dear academician, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It's an honor for me to be speaking to you this morning. I'm really thankful for being part of this today. And thank you very much, Professor. I learned a lot from your presentation today. And it has so many, it means a lot to me because I'm really engaged in working with Muslims globally to tackle issue related to the integration of Muslims. The theme of the conference actually, it's Islam, human rights, and European Union. You know, it's very important to understand the way that we Muslims think when we participate in such events, when we receive calls from others related to things in the name of religion. And this is actually why I chose the title of what I want, of my speech actually, about when the history cripples the future. We live in the 21st century, and it's our responsibility to try to create a better world for the new generation, a world where everyone will enjoy security, stability, and prosperity. And this is why it's very important to understand that there are so many challenges that we are facing in our daily life, because we are still, you know, prisoner of the past. We still mandated by a history that or events happened centuries ago. When it comes to the Muslims talking about Islam, especially in Europe, there is an issue that we all have to understand about Muslim. We, as Muslim, we have a challenge related to our identity. Who are we? When we talk about Muslim in Europe, the main challenge that they are faced with is, are they European or are they Muslim? When you talk with Muslims in Germany, in Greece, in Italy, always they have this challenge within themselves. Are we Italian or are we Muslim? Are we Greece or are we Muslim? Are we German or are we Muslim? Because they feel that they can't combine these two together. Because they always hear we and you. You see, they hear it from politicians, they hear it from academicians, wherever they go, the approach to them that you and we. And as if when we talk about a certain nation, that these Muslims are not part of that nation. And this is, I think, an issue should be of a concern to any country and should be dealt with a priority related to national security. Because Muslims in Europe are part of Europe. They are European. Muslim in Germany are German. Muslim in France are French. Muslim in Greece are Greece. And they should be dealt with as citizens, as others, not as second-class citizens. I am trying to bring to you the way that Muslims look at, you know, how are these countries and the other community deal with them. So when you say Islam and human rights and the European Union, Muslims will feel, oh, they want to say that they are accusing Islam of violation of human rights. They don't see the good side that you might be, you know, presenting in such an event. So it's very important to put yourself in the Muslim shoes, understand the way they think, understand how they interact with the approach that they get from politicians and academicians and others in Europe. The main thing that you have to understand, we as Muslims, not only in Europe, everywhere, we have an issue of identity. Some of us still are hijacked and want to live in the past, you know, and we have a memory that we got through our educational system, through our religious leaders, a narrative that showed that we are superior. We were superior because of our religion, and we should be also, you know, superior now because of our religion. And this is an issue still, unfortunately, in the Muslim world. We didn't see the right religious leaders to come forward and tell us a history is a history. The past has gone. We are living in the 21st century, and we have to create a better future to the new generation. Every nation, they have the right to be proud of their history, but they shouldn't be prisoner of that history. They shouldn't try to bring history to the present and dominate the future by the past and history. This is an issue that we as Muslim have it, and we are struggling with it. You have to understand it. It's not only in Europe, it's everywhere. This is why you in Europe, you have to help Muslim in Europe come over this challenge. And the only way to do that is to send them the right message that they are part of Europe, that they are part of you, that they share the same rights as the others. And when you approach them, you don't approach them as Muslim. You approach them as a citizen. Because we, as Muslim, when you approach us as a Muslim, we feel deeply that you are excluding us from the majority of the community. While at the same time, you are asking us, you know, to follow the rule of law and to obey the Constitution. And this is what should be done. But you have to approach us, approach Muslim in Europe as a citizen, like others. You don't differentiate between your citizen based on religion. This is what you taught the world. This is what we learned from you. But when it comes, you know, dealing with the Muslim community, you try to talk with us as a different component of the large community. And it's a crucial issue that we have to create a new narrative that Muslims in Europe are European. They have to live as citizens in each nation, loyal to that nation, proud to be citizen of that nation. They share not only the value, you always talk about the values that Muslim should share with others. That's right, that's true, they should. But at the same time, they should share the same right. They are not second class citizen. So a platform like this, conference like this, academic institution should take the lead, you see, in, you know, promoting a new concept that will integrate Muslim within their country, within their nation. You don't do this, you can't do this by issuing a degree or by a press release or by talking to the Muslim community leaders, asking them to integrate it. No. It should be through initiatives, programs that will enable Muslims to feel it deeply that they are a real citizen, that they belong here. And this is where all Europeans have to pass and forget the history. Because still, when we talk about Muslim, it's come in the back of our mind that what happened centuries ago between Muslim and Christian in Europe or in the Middle East. We have to bypass that. We have to look forward. We have to engage in things that will build bridges of respect and trust between us, and engage especially the religious leaders. I know, you know, when we talk about Europe, you always say, well, keep religion away. Religion is everywhere. It's in our life. And I'm really thankful for you that you started this conference today with the speech of His Holiness, because you need to engage religious leaders. They are very influential. They have followers. The followers are everywhere in the community. They, you know, engaging them will enable us, all of us, to create a unified community that will work together to create a community that will enjoy security, stability, and prosperity. Never exclude religious leaders. You have to engage them. And when I say engage them, you see, I don't want just to say, I don't mean by it is the religious dialogue. No, it's more than that. We have to move to the next level where we engage religious leaders in everything in our life, not in politics, but show them the added value. Because if they are not engaged, you will create a vacuum. You will create a vacuum that will be filled by others. So engaging the religious leaders and showing them the added value that they can bring to the whole community, to their followers, and also to the others in the community, I think it's a vital, it's very important. And this is why I urge you to engage also Muslim, not only as Muslim, but as citizen, not only in the Muslim community affairs, but in the whole nation affairs and challenges. They have to live like other citizens. They have to be proud of their nationality and citizenship, and they have to share the responsibility with others in the development of their nation. Thank you very much.